Real close. We can hear a father reading the Christmas story to his children. More than likely, his father is going to be reading out of the book of Luke. Tomorrow morning, another father will grab the Bible and he will read the Christmas story to his children. Probably most of the messages of Mark will be about the Christmas story. And they will be out of Luke. But the Bible talks about the coming of our Lord and Savior all the way from Genesis, all the way through to Revelation. The Bible has been said that you can cut it anywhere and it bleeds. Because our Bible is the living Word of God.
Amen.
Now, this evening, you would think I would ask you to turn to Luke, but I'm not. I want to turn to John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 1. Christmas is the celebration of God's love coming down, that God so loved mankind, even before he created man, he loved man, because before he created man, he had a plan to save man when man sinned, because he knew man was going to sin. So he had a plan before man was ever created, before our forefathers ever sinned. God had a plan. And in time, a Savior would come and tell of God's love and show that love by the great sacrifice, the greatest sacrifice of all time. Listen to the words which tell of God's love before his love came down. John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather in your house this afternoon. And Father, may we worship. We thank you. We thank you for this day and what it means. We thank you for tomorrow, and we celebrate the birth of our Savior. And in Christ's name, I pray these things. Amen. Amen. This passage, hear me, is one of the summits of Scripture. In fact, it probably reaches the highest that man can possibly come to understand, and cannot do it without the Holy Spirit helping us understand what Christ is saying here. What is the highest that reaches the height of man's understanding? Simply is, Jesus is the Son of God, and he is the Word of God. Creator of life, and he is the very being and essence of life. But how important is it that we understand those things? If Jesus Christ is the Word of God, then man must hear and understand the Word, or else be lost forever in the ignorance of God himself. Because God sent Jesus as the Word to explain himself. A word is composed of letters. Yes? Jesus Christ, the Bible says, is the Alpha and the Omega. The first and the last letters of the Greek alphabet. So Jesus is the beginning of Word. He is the end of Word. He is the Alpha and he is the Omega. According to Hebrews, Jesus Christ is God's last word of revealing himself. We We see in what we read that Jesus also is the eternal Word, and He was existing before the beginning. Not because He had a beginning as a creator or a creation, but because He was eternal. Always has existed. Greatest of Christ's love is apparent as He identified Himself as the Word. Now hear me. Because it means, here is that Christ has always sought to reveal Himself to mankind. Always sought to reveal Himself to me and you. In the beginning, you could read it this way. In the beginning was the communication. Not just in the beginning was the Word, but in the beginning was the communication that God communicated with man through Jesus Christ, letting man know who God was and is. Christ was always the Word. Should remind us that He has always loved us. His very nature is love, and He sought an object to love. Praise God, that's you and me.
Amen.
He sought an object in this you and me to love. And at Christmas, as we look at the manger, as we hear the Christmas song, we should remember that Christ came. Now hear me. As you look tomorrow at the Christmas scenes and you look at a manger, remember that Christ came to communicate with you and I. Well, now, verse 4 changes from Jesus being the eternal Word and Creator to how His love was received. Verse 4, in Him, being Christ, was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it yet. In clearest terms, Christ is described as light. In Him was life, and that life was the light of man. The light shines in the darkness. You can have absolute darkness. Well, in reality, there's no such thing as absolute darkness. There is always some light in the darkness. No matter how dark it is, there's always light in the dark. And the light comes and illuminates the darkness and expels the darkness. That's what Jesus has done. In the beginning, God says light. In Genesis 1:1, it says, in the beginning, God, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. Now hear me. Think about this tomorrow. When Jesus was born, God said, let there be light. And Jesus was born. He came that we might have life and light. But the emphasis here is on Jesus being spiritual. Life giving light to a dark world. The thought of our Lord being spiritual light gives us an encouraging insight into His love. That the light came down to the world. Where light goes, darkness leaves. The light shines in the darkness. Literally, this means it shines continuously. This word is in the perfect text, which means that it continues to shine. It shines always.
Amen.
Look at verse 9. There was the true light, which coming into the world enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through Him, and the world did not know Him. He came to His own, and those who were His own did not receive Him. But But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even those who believe in his name. Sadly, when Jesus came, and even now, most of the world has rejected Jesus as being the light of the world. Sadly, the majority of mankind rejected the light. Mankind thinks that they live just fine in the dark. But the light has come. God's love is so strong that the light still shines and continues to see the hostile heart and bring them to himself. Okay, here are the next verse. Verse 12. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. Those who receive the light become part of the family. Part of the family of God. Just think about that. God says, I created everything and he doesn't need us, but he says, I love you to the point I'll send my only begotten son to die for you. And if you accept that, I won't just save you. I'll do more than that. I'll make you part of the family. So he makes us part of his family. That is an outstanding truth. Apparently John never got over that, understanding that. He wrote later on in 1 John 3:1, how great is the love the Father has lavished. When you look at the word lavish, it means to just pour all over. It means to just flood. Let me tell you, God loved us so much that he flooded us. He lavished us with his love.
Amen.
You know there had to be a great love to send his only son. That we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. Even though most rejected this baby that was born on Christmas Day, those that accepted him became children of God in a new birth. In verse 13, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Whew. Listen to what that says. It says that God so loved the world, he so loved you, that he called you to himself, not by birth, not by blood, but by a new birth, by the will of God.
Amen.
What was that saying? Well, it's simply saying this. Because your grandmother was saved doesn't mean you're saved. Because your mother believed in the Lord Jesus Christ doesn't mean you're saved. It means not by the will of the blood, not by the will of the flesh, not by the will of man. I tell you what, there's a lot of mothers today that wish they could will their children into heaven. Amen?
Amen.
But you can't. The Lord has to call them, and he will, if they have a choice or not. But of God. What a verse. What a verse. The statement is, because my parents are children of God doesn't make me a child of God. That's something I have to do. It is not of human desire. It is not of the flesh. It is not of human design. It is not of man. It is of God. Now, just a moment longer. No amount of parenting, no amount of personal resolve can make you a child of God. I may use all my strength of character to live a good life, perform righteous duties. I may even achieve great things in the spiritual realm, but that does not make me a child of God. I have to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior to become a child of God. I have to be born of God. That's what verse 12 says. But as many as receive him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name. Some say that the verse that we read in verse who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Some say, well, that meaning Jesus Christ. Well, I don't think so. That's referring to you and I. But let's take it that it does mean Christ. What does that say? It means he had a virgin birth. Guess what? He had a virgin birth. All right, let's proceed on just for a moment. Now the next verse, in my opinion, is one of the greatest verses in all of Scripture. Of which, little taste, I'm going to continue this message on tomorrow with this next verse. Some of you are thinking, well, I came tonight where I wouldn't have to come tomorrow. You don't want to miss this next verse because it's one of the greatest verses in my opinion in all of Scripture. So what does it say? Well, let's read verse 14. And the Word, Christ, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw his glory. Glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and full of truth. Here we are, Christmas Eve. Most of us in here tonight are children of God because we have believed in his name, meaning that we believe that he, the Son of God, the Son of the Almighty God, and that he died for my sins and I have a new birth. Here we are, Christmas Eve, and the light of God is still shining, drawing men to himself. Hear me, and I will close. Coming into this marvelous life of being a child of God, I have that assurance of salvation. I have that blessed assurance that Jesus is mine, and I have that foretaste of glory. Goodbye. And that's as close as you want me to sing. Coming one of God's own, coming by receiving Jesus, we first dwell explained by saying, all who receive him, those who believe in his name, which means believing who Jesus is, come to be children of God. In the language of John 1, the cosmic Christ, the eternal creator, who became one of us, took our sins upon himself, paid for them, was crucified, rose again, and today, he sits at the right hand of the Father.
Amen.
Now, quickly. I love telling this. The Old Testament in the temple had no chairs. Why did they not have chairs in the Old Temple? Let me tell you. Because the work of the priest would never die. They had a lamb after a lamb after a lamb after a goat after a goat after a dove after a dove, and the work just continued on and on and on and on and on and on. Jesus said on the cross, it is done. It is finished. No more sacrifices needed. The ultimate sacrifice had been complete. So when he arrived at the right hand of the Father, because the work was done for us, he sat down.
Amen.
Do you truly believe in his name? That's the question. There is nothing to join, nothing to sign, just simply believe. And we didn't make it simple. Jesus made it simple. And we as mankind try to make it so complicated. Well, I would accept the Lord, but I don't want to join the Pentecostal Baptist Church. I don't join the church. Well, you know, I would, but I got a sign. No, you're comes tonight, we're going to take just a moment, we're going to have an invitation, and then we're going to have our candlelight. I say candlelight service. Would you stand with me? Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come tonight. Maybe someone has been touched by something going on outside, going on somewhere else. And now they need to come to know it. As they step out by faith, and come. As the choir's coming up, the band's coming up, if you need to come, you come. We're not going to have an invitation, but a moment you come. Go away.